I want to welcome you back to the Paulcast. This is your curator, Kurt Willems, and I'm excited, absolutely thrilled, actually, about what we're going to be doing today. But before we get there, let me just kind of catch you up on what's been going on. I love just the community that's surrounds the Paulcast, and so I want to let you know what's going on with me. First of all, I'm in my garage, bedhead, sweatshirt, and actually I'm looking around, you know, as I record. It's my recording area. I've kind of got a mess, mostly because I was getting ready for Easter service, and so I have like stuff everywhere. Oh, and I'm noticing actually down here there is a bag full of my daughter's stuffies that she had taken away from her. Bummer. Yeah, because she wasn't behaving at bedtime, which maybe that's outside of the realm of what you need to know, but I'm just kind of jumping back into the flow here for the Paulcast. And it's been about a week and a half since we last had an episode, so I'm excited. Hopefully you had a great Easter, a great Good Friday, if you can say that. And, you know, I've actually been fighting a bug, so my voice may even sound a little different than usual, but I'm doing better a little bit today. So I'm excited about that. You know, today's topic is a heavy one, and it requires that I jump into my story a bit. And so in just a few moments, I'm going to jump into my story. But I also want to just preface this by saying it's probably one that for some people is still fairly controversial. There's a variety of different kinds of people who listen to this podcast show. And so I know that, yeah, this is a tough one. And so I want to just kind of acknowledge that from the onset. I also want to say that this is one that matters, in my opinion, more than a lot of the things we've talked about. Yeah, it's fun to nerd out on Paul and Judaism and empire and these sorts of things. But when it comes to like the bare bones of the Christian faith, this is going to be a topic that really, in my opinion, has made some Christians secretly, at least, skeptical, and other Christians become not Christians. We're going to be talking about science and Paul. We're actually really going to be talking about evolution and Paul and trying to figure out, is this something that is compatible? In order to do that, of course, we're going to have to go back into Israel's scriptures. We'll be in Genesis 1 through 3 quite a bit. And eventually we're going to land in the New Testament at Romans chapter 5. So what I want to do in this episode, however, we're not going to look at scripture in this episode. I'm going to set up the problem. I'm going to tell you a bit about my journey, and then I'm going to try and get you to understand why this isn't just some intellectual sort of jargoneering that we're doing because we want to feel bloated in the mind or something, but this actually has ramifications for real people who are struggling with what it means to believe in a God. I mean, that's the bottom line. Now, again, this show isn't just for people who believe in God as I understand God. I know there are probably folks who listen that don't necessarily believe in God, but are interested in reframing religion, and that's awesome. And so hopefully these episodes give you a way to reframe the question of science and faith and how they fit together. But it's also for those of you who have struggled or who want to have better handles on real world things. And so today we're going to talk about that. Before I jump too far ahead, of course, this is a show that has been sponsored by Fresno Pacific Biblical Seminary. And it's them who have come alongside and said, we want to help resource you, Kurt, in what you're doing. We think your stuff is pretty cool. And what I get to do alongside is actually promote something I already believe in and promote personally. Their Master of Arts in Ministry, Leadership, and Culture. This is a degree that you can do. You join a cohort, and you can actually do most of the work from your home. There's one cohort meeting every year. There's a three-year process, and by the end of it, you get a master's from a seminary, and you have worked with some amazing people from around the country and maybe even beyond, maybe some Canadian folks, or who knows how far the net expands. But also, you will have heard from, at least in the current setup, Bruxy Cavey, Brian Zond, Greg Boyd. These are voices who are contributing to the current cohort's educational process, one that has many of my friends. And so if you're interested in joining a seminary situation in the near future where seminary comes to you virtually, but you're actually still connected to a vital community, this is an awesome opportunity. Go to fpu.edu/Paulcast. That's fpu.edu/Paulcast. And you're going to get all the information, fill out the little box, let them know that I sent you. And, you know, it could really be a great option, both affordable and sort of feasible for a family that isn't ready to relocate, especially. Okay, so evolution, here we go. Okay, so we're going to talk evolution, which seems kind of crazy. So when I was in my mid-20s, I was wrestling with lots of stuff. And actually, this is closer to my early before mid-20s. I was trying to figure out all kinds of things. You know, I had changed my view on hope. I realized that hope wasn't about rapturing to a place called heaven, but that hope was that heaven would eventually come down here and transform the earth. I'd really deconstructed how I understood a lot of the things that Jesus and the New Testament were talking about in the context of the Roman Empire. And so I started really wrestling with those sorts of things. And my mind actually expanded to say that there's not just one political theory that should define what it means to be Christian, that actually the way of Jesus should define what it means to be Christian. So I'd been deconstructing and wrestling and all this stuff. And then I stumbled, I mean, literally stumbled into this thing called evolution. I kind of just been a creationist by default at that point. I don't know why I hadn't wrestled with this, but I was a creationist by default. And what I mean by that is that I essentially, yeah, I believed that God was the creator. And I still believe that to this day. But I knew there were young earth creationists and there were old earth. And if you're an old earth creationist, basically you meant that days were longer, you know? That day actually had to do with an epoch of time and not a literal day. And then if you were a young earth creationist, you actually thought it was a literal day. And so you mapped out Genesis to kind of fit a literal timeline. And when you were done with that, the earth was something like 8 or 10,000 years old. And dinosaurs, if they existed, were, you know, around when Adam and Eve were. And at some point, they die out. And so yeah, there was some interesting things, you know, and to this day, that young earth creationist view is upheld in museums in, I believe it's Tennessee. Yeah, there's a museum kind of sponsored by Ken Ham and that whole ministry. And then there's now a movement called evolutionary creationism or theistic evolution. I didn't know that was a thing. And actually, when I stumbled upon this about 8 or 9 years ago, maybe, yeah, 9 years ago now. Wow. I was kind of part of the early adopters of this sort of thing when it came to my generation, I would say. In other words, it wasn't like there were tons of resources out there. Now you can go to BioLogos and, they've got tons of great resources. There's a couple of other resource pages on these sorts of things. A ton of books have been published since then. But when I started just being confronted, not only were there not a lot of resources for evangelical Christians, here's the deal. Because of that, I thought maybe I was pushing my deconstruction too far, that this might end up being the issue that made me unfaithful to Jesus Christ. That if I had pushed this particular issue too far, that at the end of the day, I might not be Christian anymore. Not because I hadn't figured out a way to bring both my faith and evolution together, but because in doing so, what if I was finally being unfaithful to Jesus? What if I was finally being unfaithful to God? And I just never have wanted that. Like, even the Paulcast, like, there's some things in here that you probably are like, dude, I didn't grow up with that. And it's a scary category. Look, when I deal with scary categories, I deal with them through the lens of someone who wants to be intellectually honest, wants to humanize our faith. And all I mean by that is that there are real people in real places with real questions and real concerns. And at the end of the day, I want my faith to be relevant to real life. And what I was finding was this could be the linchpin that ruins it all. Prayed a lot, journaled a lot, wrestled a lot, talked to friends a lot. Some people started saying things like, well, if you're an evolutionist, you can't be a Christian. So you probably don't know it yet, but you're an atheist. I started getting all kinds of stuff. But at the end of the journey, I figured out that it's actually possible to hold these two things together. And in fact, my opinion is that it might actually be more biblically faithful, but I'm going to get there eventually. And it's not, here's a disclaimer. One of my presuppositions is that the Bible isn't trying to teach science, okay? So I'm not going to try and show you how in the Bible, it clearly teaches evolution. The Bible doesn't teach evolution, but it doesn't teach young earth creationism either. It doesn't teach old earth. It doesn't teach a method. It only teaches a vision. And when we tie the vision of a creator and the method of the creation too closely together, what we end up with is something that is incompatible, that science and faith don't work. And so through that journey, I have had to really figure out what I believe, and some great resources in the coming years. That was probably 2008 or so when I started asking that question, when I was confronted with it. And by the time I wrote some of my initial research in seminary, actually, on this very topic, it was already 2012, and books were coming out and resources were available. Studies were coming out about millennials. And so I'm going to just highlight some of that right now. You may be asking, though, but seriously, Kurt, like, is this a big deal? Is this really a big deal? Yeah. I'm going to show you why it's a big deal. I think there's a huge problem. Before I do, though, let me be clear about what I mean by evolution. Right. So macroevolution is like evolutionary theory that we've all grown up hearing about. Old Earth, there are massive shifts that happen in the universe that are driven by these micro evolutionary realities where species adapt and change. And so some Christians have said, yeah, we can observe micro evolutionary changes, but that doesn't mean it's a macro thing. In other words, there's a distinction here. If none of this makes sense to you, it barely makes sense to me, so don't worry about it. Another caveat, I am not a science guy. I'm just going to give you the Bible stuff. I tend to be a Bible guy. But I do want to have like a clear definition. So I only bring that up to say, here's my definition of evolution. Number one, the universe emerged about 13.7 billion years ago. Okay. So Big Bang, whatever we want to call it, this happens 13.7 billion years ago, give or take. Of course, we don't know exactly, but based on the best hypothetical data that we have right now, this is what evolution teaches. This is what our science books teach. This is what almost every PhD scientist believes. There are a few exceptions, but there are exceptions. The vast majority, by the way, the vast majority of Christian scientists believe in an old earth with real evolution. Okay. Next one is the first forms of cellular life on the earth. They occur about 4.5 billion years ago. Third, all species descended from common ancestors and find their origin in a single-celled organism, okay? So there is an organism that adapts, it changes, and multiple species come out of this. So yes, we'll get to it, but yes, in one very broad sense, humans were not always humans as we know humans today, okay? So number four, species change over time through mutations in DNA. Five, humans, the first ones, right? The first humans most likely evolved from a tribe of chimp-like apes in Africa, probably 6 to 7 million years ago. And Homo sapiens, so like you and I, like modern Homo sapiens, can be dated to about 200,000 years ago. That is what every science book teaches. That's not rooted in creation science, right? And so these are what I'm talking about. I believe, I am strongly convinced that all of this could be very, very true. And if your reason for trying to disprove evolution is because the Bible tells you so, you are reading the wrong Bible. I'm going to be that bold. Or at least you're reading it with a lens that isn't actually helpful. A lens that you inherited from a problem that was generated about 100 years ago or so when people had to defend their faith against evolution. And so there emerged this vision of Christianity called fundamentalism. And fundamentalism takes the charge of literalism so seriously that this great cultural divide happens through the 1900s. And by the time we are at the end of the 20th century, it is one of the major culture wars, one that is still being fought today. Because not only do lots of Christians say evolution, that's a hoax, and it's a hoax so much that we are going to spend all of our time and energy defending the Bible, but then they translate it into their politics. They translate it into their vision of other areas of science. So not only is this a problem, like in a proper sense, but now it's like we can't trust evolution, so we definitely can't trust global warming or climate change as real things, especially if the earth isn't that old. There hasn't been time for these changes, that, right? So again, it bleeds out beyond just a science theory. It bleeds into politics. It bleeds into dialogue. And here at the Paulcast, we're all about intelligent and humanizing dialogue. And well, friends, this conversation, this culture war has been neither intelligent nor humanizing most of the time. So we're going to wrestle with that. And in fact, it's been such a bad conversation that we've had some dire results. And this is like what I want us to just land on today in this episode. And then we're going to get into the scriptures shortly after in other episodes, is young adults are leaving or avoiding the church in mass, my friends. Now, these stats are from a few years ago, probably around 2012 or so. But the Barna Group observed this, that churches come across as antagonistic to science. And this is one of the reasons, based on their data, that young adults are just like done. They're just done. They don't want to be part of an institution that can't affirm basic scientific knowledge. And in fact, 72% of people, according to a Pew survey, that are religiously unaffiliated also hold to evolution as a fact. So hear me on this. Like, if you're more conservative or traditional on this issue as you come into this series, which, by the way, if that's where you leave this series, I respect you. It's okay. I just want you to know that there's more options. Then here's the deal. You ought to be so concerned about this reality that you say, even though I'm strongly convinced that evolution is a hoax, I am going to hold out the possibility that I am wrong for the sake of holding within my reach of care younger Christians for whom this is a really big deal. It's not just an intellectual deal. It is a problem that is leaving people to leave the church. Leading people to leave the church. And that's a big deal. That's a huge deal. Here's another thing. I think one of the problems is that pastors perpetuate the problem. Pastors and church leaders do not address these things with honesty, intellectually, or even where they're at. And here's, I get it. I'm a pastor. I understand this. I've worked in several different contexts. Here's the deal. Most pastors could lose their job if they were honest about this. And so why even explore it? It's non-essential. We don't need to talk about this because at the end of the day, it's not a salvation issue. We might use all of this jargon, but here's the thing. Your concern as a pastor or leader that this is not a so-called salvation issue or so-called essential issue, which I have a problem with those categories in general, but that's a different episode. Here's the deal. We're, as pastors, perpetuating a problem that is unnecessary. Here's the deal. The Lifeway Research did this same sort of exploration. And this was, this was a poll that came out about the same time, about 2012. And this is what it said. The statement, "I believe God used evolution to create people." 64% of Protestant pastors that were polled strongly disagree with that. Emphasize this strongly. 64% strongly disagreed with that. So it wasn't like, oh, I'm not sure. There's some question marks here. I'm not confident. It's strongly disagree. So there is a pocket of pastors who have come up in seminary systems or education systems or cultural systems that have taught them that evolution cannot possibly be true. 64% of them are hard on that. But then 8% somewhat disagree with, you know, this statement. 12% somewhat agree with it. So there's, now we're moving towards, yeah, God probably could have done that. And then 20 or another 12% strongly agree with it. There's 4% that weren't sure. So you get the idea that we, by not wrestling with important issues because they are so-called non-essentials, or setting ourselves up as the agents of truth versus all of that secular stuff that is untrue, especially science, we are perpetuating something that is leading to a real, real problem, my friends. Here's another problem. Scientific naturalism. So I'm going to call this out too. So it's not just a Christian problem, but there is something called scientific naturalism or evolution as a worldview. And this is a problem as well, because on a polarity spectrum, on one end, you have certain Christians who believe evolution is the same as atheism and could never be biblical. And then on the other side of the spectrum, you have folks that are so anti-Christian that scientific naturalism has emerged as a worldview rather than a way in which the world has come into being, right? So Tim Keller, who I love quoting Tim Keller because we are so different in so many areas, but dude gets it in very important areas. So here's what he said. He said, "Belief in evolution as a biological process is not the same as belief in evolution as a worldview." Super important that we make this distinction. Alvin Plantinga, he says this, "What is not consistent with Christian belief is the claim that this process of evolution is unguided, that no personal agent, not even God, has guided, directed, orchestrated, or shaped it." So here's the thing. There are people who do not believe that God had anything to do with it. And why should they believe that God had anything to do with it if they're not followers of Jesus, if they're not Christian or at least religious in some sense? Fair enough. That is a religious conviction, not a scientific one, right? But here's what happens on the other end of the spectrum is their belief in evolution has led to a worldview that says God isn't possible. Like God couldn't have been possible here. God is a myth that humans create along the way, and everything we need to know can be known through science. And I just want to call it out as, well, BS. Right? Both sides of that spectrum are unnecessary tying together of the Bible and science. You see, what happens is when we as Christians tie the Bible and science together in ways that are unnecessary, then the scientific community and parts of it, not all of it, by the way, a lot of scientists that affirm God and evolution, but what we end up with on the other side of the spectrum is those Christians and their Bible, that's silly. Of course, Adam and Eve weren't the first humans. Of course, it didn't happen in 7 days, right? So they start using very rigid, literalistic assumptions about what the Bible actually teaches to defend their view that there couldn't be a God because that fundamentalist idea of the Bible is clearly false. And so we reinforce each other's problems on both sides of the spectrum. And what I want to say is, It's because we're reading the Bible wrong. We're reading it wrong. So I want to throw out a big idea, and this is where we're going to land today. We're going to land with this. I believe that the antagonistic stance toward biological evolution is unnecessarily hindering some people from becoming or remaining part of the Christian faith, when in fact the biblical witness of cosmic and human origins in no way conflicts with modern science. That's my conviction. That is my hard conviction. In fact, Augustine has this idea in his writings of two books, and I'll probably come back to this, but he says there's a book of nature and there is a book of scripture, and he urges Christians that when we have a belief about our book that is clearly not true about what is true in nature, and these come into conflict, we will look foolish. We will look foolish to not make space for them both to be true. That two books have to inform our understanding of God, not just one. And friends, I want us to hold that together. And here's the problem. We don't have to mix the books. They can hold weight individually on their own. You know, I love what Paul says in Romans 14, and I'll land with this. He says, therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in the way of a brother or sister. That's Romans 14, 13. For too long, my friends, evolution versus biblical literalism has been a problem. And my intention is to show you how it is not only possible, but the best way to at least say, I'm going to defer science to scientists. And what I know about the Bible is that the way we can read the Bible with full integrity, in its context, with all of its intent in mind, we can do that with integrity without having to disrupt the integrity of science, because, my friends, they were never meant to be interwoven. They are separate. Okay, so I'm take a pause from that. And hopefully at this point, you are in a place where you're like, okay, I'm intrigued. He's convinced me that it's at least an issue. And that if we're going to read Paul, because by the time, my friends, we get to Romans 5, we have to deal with a really big question. What about Adam and Eve? And we're going to get there. It's going to take several episodes to get to what about Adam and Eve as Paul understands Adam and Eve. But we'll get there. So hold that in the back of your mind, because Paul's going to say that basically salvation and how we understand the first human versus the renewed Jesus human, the first Adam and the second Adam, we might say, he's going to say, this is like salvation history 101. So we're going to have to ask some hard questions about Adam and Eve and how it relates to Jesus and redemption and all of that in Paul. But that's going to be on the back end of this series, because we're going to have to do some real hard homework. We have to jump into the worldview of Paul. We have to jump into the worldview of Second Temple Judaism and ask ourselves, what does Genesis 1 have to say to us? What does Genesis 2 through 3 have to say to us? What are other relevant texts that we need to explore? And then jump into the New Testament. Oh, and it's going to be fun. Oh my gosh, it's going to be fun. So don't give up on the process. And allow for the, what do I need to know here? Tension, question marks, etc. And by the end of the series, I hope you're equipped with the basic information to hold science and scripture, not interwovenly, but side by side. Well, friends, before we jump into a final thought on this, I want to remind us, Fresno Pacific Biblical Seminary, our sponsor, hit them up. If you are curious about seminary and being part of a learning community where you can get a master's degree from your home, I mean, it's just such a great deal. So go check this out, fpu.edu/Paulcast. That's fpu.edu/Paulcast. And they are going to give you an opportunity to learn, grow, and become a better leader, a better theologian, and a better human, in my opinion. as you grow in your own formation. Okay, so here's a final thought that I want you to consider with me. This comes from Mark. So we're reading the Gospel of Mark. We're not in Paul at the moment, although the thrust of this series will lead us to Paul. But I want you to just get your head around part of the problem. And this has been just an easy illustration, okay? So here's what Jesus says in Mark chapter 4, verse 30 through 32. It says this. He continued, "What's a good image for God's kingdom? What parable can I use to explain it? Consider a mustard seed. When scattered on the ground, it's the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. But when it's planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all vegetable plants. It produces such large branches that the birds in the sky are able to nest in its shade." Hear me on this. Jesus is wrong. What? Yeah. No, I'm going to be blunt really quick. Jesus was wrong. Now, why was Jesus saying what he said? He is in a first century Palestinian context. And so, of course, he's going to say that something is small in the way that everyone else would believe it's small. But check this out. He says that the mustard seed is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. He makes a blanket statement. Friends, we know this is untrue. Like, we just know that there are smaller seeds that exist in nature. There are smaller seeds that exist in the world. Jesus uses it here casually as an illustration, no doubt. But we know, scientifically, that Jesus is wrong. So we either have one or two options here, in my opinion. Option number one is we say Jesus is wrong, therefore the Bible is wrong. Right, that would be the scientific naturalist approach that has bought into the categories of certain forms of fundamentalism. Literally, Jesus is wrong, therefore, naturally, right? Or we can accommodate and make all kinds of things go and figure it out. But look, at the end of the day, Jesus is wrong. But of course, there's a couple of things here. Number one, Jesus is speaking to a very specific audience who would have the same belief that he just communicated. His point here isn't, let me tell you scientifically which seed is the smallest. No. He probably did believe that, though. The human Jesus probably did believe that. Remember, Jesus is both human and divine in the Bible. And so here, Jesus, speaking in his humanity, is speaking what people know. But Jesus makes the claim. It is the smallest of the seeds. And if we take Jesus on his word, Jesus is actually wrong. I hope that this illustrates the problem for you. I hope it just, like when you try and deduce science from scripture, you're going to run into all kinds of weird things. It just isn't going to work. So we have to reconsider a couple of things. What's the best way to read the Bible? And what's the best way to understand science? And let's pull these guys apart until we have both theories worked out well. And then we can bring them back together and say, oh, they actually can dance after all. They actually can hang together after all. They're actually not in competition after all. The credibility of the Jesus movement is at stake here, my friends. The credibility of what we hold dear is at stake here. But not just that. The integrity of how we read ancient documents, no matter what we believe about their inspiration, God, etc., the integrity of how we read these classical documents we happen to call scripture is equally at stake. Friends, we can do better. And in this series on Paul and evolution, We're going to do better. Stay tuned, my friends. I'm excited for what is to come. Want to let you know about a couple of things as you part from this episode. Here's the first one. It's kind of exciting. If you go to paulcast.org, you're actually going to be redirected to the new theologycurator.com. Now, you've heard me refer to myself as the curator of the Paulcast for over a year now. And as I've sat with what I want this to become, I've realized that it could become even more, right? And so I've been dreaming, I've been having some fun. And one of the things that I'm doing right now is I'm preparing for a grand unveiling of the Theology Curator Network, which eventually is going to house multiple podcasts and is going to be a written resource for intelligent and humanizing faith conversations. So there's going to be articles integrated in there, and there already are a couple, just to sort of get the site into a usable condition in case someone happens to pop over. But right now, I'm revamping everything. We've got a new sort of format for the newsletter. So Paulcast is growing. And eventually we're going to have a couple of other podcasts, but we're also going to have a written library of intelligent resources. So dealing with Jesus, Paul, Revelation, New Testament, and theology. And then the other half of the website is going to be much more ministry focused, or faith focused, I should say. Ministry, peacemaking and justice, church planting, actually. And then beyond that, because I am making podcasts, I'm actually excited about this too. I'm going to share with you what I do. And I'm a guy who's had to hack it. I don't know technology. I don't know a lot of things, but I'm going to share with you the things that I do know about how to build a platform online, how to launch podcasts or church websites or blogs and these sorts of things. All things I've had to learn along the way. And I'm going to also, here we go. I'm even going to start creating online courses that you can sign up for to immerse you a level deeper into the world of Paul, Jesus, Revelation, the New Testament, all the things that I'm passionate about. I'm going to start creating content that you can actually go through in a class format. And so all of this is on the horizon. It's going to take time to develop, but step one was building out a website where this was possible. Go to theologycurator.com and check this out. And then also, if this is your first time on the Paulcast, I hope you subscribe and go to iTunes, especially. Most people do it on iTunes, but go there and give a review. We're climbing in the reviews. We are almost near 100 on iTunes, and that helps keep us visible. And so I hope you'll do that, because here at the Paulcast, here's our commitment. And on Theology Curator as a whole, as we move forward, our commitment is to cultivate space where intelligent and humanizing conversations are actually possible about God and faith. And I hope you will join us in this journey, and you will share this vision with all kinds of people, because the more people we have talking about God in these sorts of ways, the more we're going to move forward in ways that's actually going to be good for Jesus, for the mission of the church, and for the culture at large. I hope you'll join me in that process. Come back for the next episode on Paul and science as we wrestle with, can we read scripture and deal with evolution together with integrity?